The last time we had the class on normal preparium, today we are going to deal with the problems that can happen during preparium, okay? You can see the slide properly? Can you see the slide properly?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So abnormal preparium is any complication that can arising in the preparium would lead to abnormal preparium. Okay, so the most common problem that can happen in preparium is prepural pyrexia. The second one is venous thrombosis and pulmonary embolism. Third is secondary postpartum hemorrhage. Fourth is obstetric palsies. And fifth one is psychiatric problem during the preparium. Okay, so during this five problem, among these five problems, I'm going to deal with prepural pyrexia today. And venous thrombosis and pulmonary thromboembolism must have been dealt in medicine. Secondary postpartum hemorrhage, PPH ko class ma padhai saknu bhaye hola, you know. And obstetric palsies and psychiatric problems, those are not very much important, but I'm just going to go in briefly in among this topic. So I'm going to focus more on prepural pyrexia today, okay? So what is prepural pyrexia? The rise of temperature reaching to 100.4 degree Fahrenheit or 38 degree centigrade or more on two separate occasions, 24 hours apart, within 10 days postpartum, excluding first 24 hours, and to be taken by standard oral technique at least 4 times daily. Okay, so we have to mention all these points. The fever should be more than 38 degree centigrade, and it should be measured on two occasions at least 24 hours apart. Within 10 days postpartum, excluding the first 24 hours, and to be taken by standard oral technique. Okay, now this is just a definition of prepural pyrexia. So if a lady gets fever during preparium, then she is labeled as prepural pyrexia. Now you have to find the cause of fever. Okay, so now coming to causes of prepural pyrexia, the most common cause, the most important one, is prepural sepsis. Second is urinary tract infection. Third is breast complication, wound infection, any respiratory complication in the preparium, thrombophlebitis, and intercurrent infection. Coming to prepural sepsis, what is prepural sepsis? This is just an infection of the genital tract during preparium, which occurs as a complication of delivery. Okay, so most common cause of prepural pyrexia is prepural sepsis. And what are the organisms that causes prepural sepsis? That is the organism that invade the placental site, laceration and incision as consequence of delivery are those that normally colonizes the perineum, vagina, and the cervix. You all know, Anna, female genital tract is not sterile. There are certain organisms harboring there. Okay, so those are known as commensal organisms. But under various conditions, this commensal organism becomes pathologic. Okay, so that will cause infection on that site. So the main thing is you have to know the bacteriology of why this vaginal flora becomes pathogenic. Otherwise, it was a commensal, it was non-pathogenic, it was there in the female. Okay, and now it has become pathogenic. Why it has become pathogenic? It depends upon the following condition. The condition that lowers the resistance of the woman, that is either local or general condition that lowers the resistance. Second is condition favoring multiplication of the bacteria. Okay, and third is introduction of organism from outside. So any of these three criteria, if it is present, then that can lead to the commensal being pathogenic. Okay, I told you condition that lowers the resistance means if the patient is anemic, if she has low immunity, if she is from the low socioeconomic status, then she becomes more prone to infection. Condition favoring multiplication means if there is a small piece of placenta is retained inside the uterus. So that becomes the foreign body, that becomes a dead tissue, and the multiplication of the bacteria would be there. Or sometimes if you forget a gauze piece inside the vagina during repair of episiotomy, you have kept a gauze piece and you forget to take it out. That also acts as a foreign body and favors the multiplication of bacteria. And introduction of organism means when you are doing PV examination, you have not taken proper precaution, okay? You have not taken proper precaution, and then every time you do internal examination, you introduce the organism from outside. Now, what are the bacteria that are responsible for female genital tract infection? It is a polymicrobial infection, okay? There's not a specific, there's nothing like only this bacteria will cause infection. Okay, so it is a polymicrobial. There is aerobic, anaerobic, and other organisms. So aerobic could be gram positive, gram negative, and even in gram positive, it is group A and B streptococcus, enterococcus, staphylococcus, and gram negative bacteria, it could be E. coli, Klebsiella, Proteus. In an anaerobic, it could be Peptostreptococcus, Bacteroides, Clostridium, Fusobacterium, okay? And others could be because of Mycoplasma, Chlamydia. So you all know now, the puerperal sepsis is a polymicrobial infection. There are so many bacteria, both aerobic, anaerobic, and causing infection, okay? Now, what are the predisposing factors of puerperal sepsis? Because there are 100 women delivering here, and only one will get infection, the 99 will not get infection. So why is like that? It is, and maybe that one lady has some predisposing factor. So you should be knowing what are the predisposing factors. So antepartum is malnourishment, anemia, if she comes from low socioeconomic class, sexual intercourse in the late pregnancy, and it could be pre-labor rupture of membrane. Intrapartum, if you have done repeated internal examination, especially after rupture of membrane, you're doing PV on and on. If there's prolonged labor, if there's placenta previa, traumatic vaginal operative delivery, intrauterine manipulation, and if there is postpartum hemorrhage. So all these things can lead to puerperal sepsis, infection of the female genital tract, okay? And in postpartum, like you have delivered the placenta, and the chunk of placenta is still retained inside the uterus, okay? So that will act as a foreign body and make the woman more prone to infection, right? So these are the risk factor or predisposing factor: antepartum, intrapartum, and postpartum. Basically, what is puerperal sepsis? It is basically wound infection only. So infection of the perineum, vagina, and the cervix, you know, can infection on the one that mainly counts at all, because once you have delivered, you have given episiotomy, right? Or even if you have not given episiotomy, there can be tear, perineal tears. So basically, the infection can happen in that site. The infection of the perineal wound, including episiotomy and repaired laceration, relatively uncommon considering the bacterial contamination that follows the delivery. What are the signs and symptoms? When the opposing wound edges become red, it becomes swollen and edematous, sometimes become necrotic and slough off. Suture tear through edematous tissue, allowing wound edge to gap. A serous and serous sanguineous or purulent discharge will start coming from the wound. And in extreme cases, entire vulva becomes edematous, ulcerated, and covered with slough. Okay? So, pathology. What are the signs of inflammation on that? Rubber, dollar, pallor, so something like that. Red, swollen, edematous, and becomes necrotic and it's slough off. These are the signs and symptoms of wound infection. So this is the picture. Okay. It's episiotomy, it has gaped, and you can see this yellow area in between. This is the slough. Okay. And with repeated cleaning, the wound has become healthy. And this red area is granulation tissue. Okay. Now, how do you treat the infected perineal wound? The infected perineal wound, the sutures, they need to be removed, because now there's no use of keeping the suture in the wound area, because wound has already get infected and it has gaped. Okay. So there's no point keeping the sutures, because sutures will now act as the foreign body and more bacteria will grow on that. So we have to remove the suture. An infected wound should be left open, okay? So you have to open the wound, clean it properly. Every day you do dressing, scrub it properly, give broad spectrum antibiotic, and sometimes it will heal by granulation tissue. So if it heals by granulation tissue, then that is called healing by secondary intention. Or what you can do is, when there is granulation tissue comes and wound becomes clean, like I showed you this one, if the wound has become clean and there is granulation tissue, there is no slough, then we can again freshen up this margin and resuture the gaped wound. Okay, so we can again suture it, but we have to freshen this area. I'm showing you in the arrow, this area, it has to be freshened up and again give an incision over here, and then we can repair it. That is called resuturing or secondary suturing. Okay. Same with episiotomy, gaped episiotomy wound. We have to remove all the sutures, leave the wound open, give the broad spectrum antibiotic, clean it properly every day. And when the pink granulation tissue are present and slough is not there, then we can again suture it, and which is known as resuturing or secondary suturing, right? Uterine infection generally occurs within 3 to 6 days. Following vaginal delivery, infection counts. So primarily, it involves the placental implant is inside, okay? So mainly, that area is more ragged, so it will involve that area. In cesarean section, the organism will invade the devitalized uterine tissue at the uterine incision site, where you have cut the uterus, that is the site more prone to get infected, okay? In vaginal delivery, the area where placenta was implanted was important. And in cesarean section, where you have cut the uterus, that area becomes more prone to infection. Now, coming to signs and symptoms of uterine infection, there's profuse foul-smelling discharge for vaginum, okay? So just by looking at the lochia, smelling the lochia, you can say, no, this lady has puerperal sepsis, okay? There can be bleeding PV, sometimes very scanty discharge. Patient may come with malaise, fever with chills and rigor. There can be tachycardia, uterine subinvolution, abdominal tenderness, uterine and parametrial tenderness, and leukocytosis. So these are all signs and symptoms of puerperal sepsis. If the infection is confined to the endometrium or to the decidua and superficial myometrium, okay? So infection is just to the superficial layer of the uterus, then these are mild cases and they have less clinical presentation. Patient can come with mild fever or pain in abdomen or something like that. But if it spreads beyond this area, if the infection has gone into the myometrium, then that is severe and patient can present very, can have toxic presentation, okay? The patient can present with high-grade fever, with chills and rigor, and a patient looks very sick, and there's very foul-smelling discharge. When you do a PV examination, the uterus is very tender, and patient looks very toxic, okay? So that's how they present, if the infection is beyond the superficial layer. If that infection spreads beyond the uterus, it can go into the parametrium, okay? So parametrial extension is the complication of puerperal sepsis. So that is called parametritis. In the parametrium, there is tube, okay? So if the tube gets infected, that's called perisalpingitis. Or if there is infection of the ovary leading to pus collection over there, then that can lead to ovarian abscess. And if the pus gets collected in the pelvic cavity, that can lead to pelvic abscess, peritonitis, and septic pelvic thrombophlebitis. These are all complications of puerperal sepsis. It is basically the infection has spread beyond the uterus and has gone into the parametrium or in the pelvis and in the veins. Okay, so that is the complication. Now, how do you diagnose? Cases of puerperal pyrexia is to be considered due to puerperal sepsis unless proved otherwise. Okay, so in the puerperium, if a lady has fever, suppose she has fever 102 today, you go tomorrow, she's running temperature of 101, then she becomes a case of puerperal pyrexia. And the most common cause is puerperal sepsis, unless it is proven otherwise. So now you have to take history if a lady has fever. So what all history will you take? So you have to take the history of duration of rupture of membrane, duration of labor, number of internal examination done, method of delivery, internal manipulation, trauma to genital tract, which was repaired or not. And then examination, you have to see the temperature and pulse charting. Always, although I said the fever could be mainly because of puerperal sepsis, but you have to look for other causes also, okay? So you have to examine the breast, chest, heart, liver, spleen, and throat. And on abdominal examination, you have to note the involution of the uterus. Look for uterine tenderness and presence of features of peritonitis. And on paravaginal examination, you have to look at the condition of the perineal wound, color and smell of lochia, and always check for retained product of conception. What are the investigations we are going to send? We have to send the complete blood count, okay, which includes hemoglobin, total count, differential count. You have to send that, and platelet count is also there. And again, you send urine routine and microscopy, urine for culture and sensitivity, blood for culture and sensitivity, because you have to look for all the causes of fever, not only sepsis. Okay, so again, the most important one is you have to send endocervical swab for culture. And ultrasound should be ordered to look for any written product of conception, and chest x-ray has to be done. Okay. Treatment. I told you, if it is superficial, just involving the deciduo only, then that is a mild infection. So you can treat her with oral antibiotic. Just give antibiotic combining these two. Either you give ampicillin or amoxicillin 500 milligram 8-hourly, plus metronidazole 500 milligram per oral 8-hourly for 7 to 10 days. Okay. Why we are combining these two medicine? Because the ampicillin or amoxicillin will act on gram-positive and gram-negative organism, and metronidazole will act on anaerobic organism. Okay. Or we can give cephalosporins plus metronidazole. Right? In severe infection, if you think your patient is toxic, she's having high-grade fever, then the oral antibiotic is not going to act. You have to admit the patient. First of all, admit the patient, give her IV fluids, send all the investigation as I have mentioned before, then only you start her on IV antibiotic. This is called empirical antibiotic because you don't know what is causing infection, okay? Because your organism, but you know what is the bacteriology? What are the organisms that might have caused infection in this lady? That's I told you before, it can be gram-positive, it can be gram-negative, it can be anaerobes. So you start empirical antibiotic in such a way that it covers all the organism, okay? So you give her injection ampicillin 1 gram IV 6-hourly. This is for gram-positive. And injection gentamicin 80 milligram IV 12-hourly. This is for gram-negative organism. And injection metronidazole 500 milligram IV 8-hourly. This is for anaerobes. So you combine antibiotic in such a way that it covers all gram-positive, gram-negative, and anaerobes. This is just empirical antibiotic. And you have collected urine routine and culture. You have sent hyvaginal swab culture, and you have sent blood culture also. Okay. When the report comes, you know, it might take 48 to 72 hours. When the report comes, if there's a growth of any organism, then you change the antibiotic accordingly. Otherwise, you continue with this antibiotic. Till when you give IV antibiotic? You have to give till the patient is afebrile for 48 hours. Okay? Improvement can be seen within 48 to 72 hours. And if the patient becomes afebrile, that might take any time. Some lady might take 3 days, 4 days, 5 days. You know? So if like a patient has become afebrile for 48 hours, then we can switch her on oral antibiotic. Okay. So if you find any written product of conception, the ultrasound says there's a small piece of placenta or some written RPOC in the uterus, then you have to remove this as early as possible under antibiotic coverage. So you give antibiotic for 24 hours, then you explore the uterus and take out the RPOC. If there's pelvic abscess, then that has to be drained, okay? Because if there is pus inside the pelvis, the no and IV antibiotic is going to work. We have to drain it. Either we can do colpotomy and drain it, or sometimes laparoscopy and drain it, or sometimes you have to do laparotomy and drain the abscess. Now, prevention. How do you prevent puerperal sepsis? So we have to restrict the multiple internal examination. Don't do multiple internal examination. Delivery should be conducted under aseptic precaution. Traumatic vaginal delivery should be avoided. Intrauterine manipulation, if required, done under aseptic condition. Laceration of the genital tract has to be repaired. Okay, so no laceration can be just left like that. You have to repair it promptly and effectively. Excessive blood loss during delivery should be replaced by blood transfusion. You know? If there is PPA, if there is postpartum hemorrhage, just don't leave the patient like that. If she has lost 1 liter of blood, so she has become anemic. Okay, so you have to replace the blood with blood. And prophylactic antibiotics has to be given in cases of PROM, prolonged labor, traumatic delivery and in case of cesarean section to avoid infection. Okay, so this is about preparatory sepsis, how to manage and what are the signs, symptoms and what are the things you do. So this is case of preparatory sepsis. Now I've just kept a slide, one slide over here regarding subinvolution. Subinvolution is when the inволution is impaired or retracted. Okay, in last class I told you within 2 weeks the uterus should be inside the pelvis. Okay, so if it is not like that, then that is called subinvolution, and this is not basically a pathological condition. Okay, it can be a physiological condition. Causes is, it is over distension of uterus, as in twin, hydramnios, big baby, of preparatory sepsis or retained placental tissue, delivery by cesarean section, presence of uterine fibroid. If the lady is not lactating, last time I told you, if a mother is lactating, then there's release of oxytocin, and that oxytocin will act on the uterus and it helps in faster involution. So only size of the uterus is not important. If the involution is associated with excessive lochia, heavy and irregular bleeding PV, foul smelling discharge PV, then it is important. The second is, the second cause of puerperal pyrexia is urinary complication in puerperium. Okay, so urinary tract infection is the most common cause of puerperal pyrexia following after puerperal sepsis. If it is not because of sepsis, then the fever could be because of urinary tract infection. Okay, so why UTI? It may be due to presence of previous infection which gets flared up in puerperium, or asymptomatic bacteriuria becomes symptomatic during puerperium. Effect of catheterization. During delivery, we catheterize the lady, okay? So this is the foreign body. When you insert the catheter, there can be chance of infection. And stasis of urine due to lack of bladder tone and decreased desire to pass urine. I told you last time also, there can be chances of urinary retention. So if there is urinary retention, that can lead to UTI. What are the organisms? As usual, gram-negative is more common. E. coli, Klebsiella, Proteus, Streptococcus, and so these are the organisms. Presentation, patient can present with fever, malaise, suprapubic tenderness, flank pain, and renal angle tenderness if kidneys are involved. Our investigation, the same investigation you will send all the investigation for puerperal pyrexia, especially giving more focus on complete blood count, urine routine and microscopy, urine culture and sensitivity, and ultrasound to see for kidney status. Okay, treatment is like you start, you know, and it is because of gram negative organism. So empirically, after sending urine culture, you start her on third generation cephalosporins, and when the culture report comes, and you then again you change her on sensitive antibiotics. Okay, so start her with broad spectrum main third generation cephalosporins. Second is another urinary complaint, urinary problem is urinary retention. This is very common in puerperium. Like I said last time, bladder sensation and its capacity to empty spontaneously is decreased in puerperium. Moreover, because of pain, less desire to pass urine. Okay, so patient, she will go to toilet, she cannot pass urine. Okay, so she has retained urine. And the treatment is simple measure. Just tell her to go to toilet, open the tap, do all those things. Even if she cannot pass urine with that also, then you just put a Foley's catheter for 24 to 48 hours. Always in the urinary retention, you have to rule out urinary tract infection. So send urine routine and culture and give her appropriate antibiotic. Keep Foley's catheter for 24 to 48 hours and just remove it. Patient is going to be fine. The third problem that can happen in puerperium is breast complication. Okay, in breast complication, there are minor problem like breast engorgement, cracked nipple, retracted nipple, or sometimes leading to a more major, that is mastitis and breast abscess. Okay, so breast engorgement, it is due to exaggerated normal venous and lymphatic engorgement of breast which precedes lactation. This prevents escape of milk from the lacteal system, and patient may present with difficulty in feeding. She will come with an engorgement. If it's a breast heavy boy, you do cure one answer. So this is engorged breast. It generally onset is 3 to 4 days of puerperium. Presentation, feeling of heaviness or tenseness in breast. There can be transient rise of temperature, but not very high. patient can have some form of malaise. Treatment is she has to breastfeed her baby regularly because she cannot keep the milk in the breast. Or if even if after feeding the baby, if she feels engorged, then she has to express the milk and take it out. Tight breast support is very important. And if she's having lots of pain, then she can take analgesics, simple analgesics for pain. The treatment is just give a tight breast support, give her some analgesic for pain and express the milk. Cracked nipple, cracked nipple is just what happens is the mother is feeding her baby, okay? She doesn't clean the nipple after feeding the baby properly. So now what happens? There's the crusting, you know, the milk will dry over the nipple. And if whenever she tries to remove that crust, the epithelium will also come out with the crust. Okay, so there is loss of surface epithelium with formation of raw area. And this fissure situated either at the tip or the base of the nipple. So that's why it is called cracked nipple if she doesn't take care of her breast properly. Causes is crusting over the nipple, or it can be because of retracted nipple, or it could be because of vigorous sucking by infant. Presentation is pain during feeding. When a patient will complain, I cannot feed the baby, there's lots of pain. So if there is infection, you know, if there is infection, then because of that crust, because of the cracked nipple, the infection might spread into the breast parenchyma, leading to mastitis. Okay. Treatment is if a lady has cracked nipple, then just give her some emollient. You know, there are so many creams in the market that is available by the name of nip cream or nip care cream. So this is just basically emollient. So she has to apply this cream over the nipple, and every time before feeding, she has to clean the area, feed the baby, and again clean the area and apply the emollient. So this can she has to apply for 5 to 7 days, and when the nipple heals properly, then she can breastfeed the baby properly. Okay, and during that time, because it is very painful for the baby to suckle the nipple, so breastfeeding should be done with nipple shield. And in severe cases, you have to stop the feeding for 24 to 48 hours, maintain proper hygiene, and then again start with breastfeeding. Retracted nipples, this is seen in primary gravida. It causes difficulty in breastfeeding, usually can be teased out by gentle pulling with finger and thumb. If she cannot feed because of retracted nipple, then she can use nipple shield to feed the baby. So this is a retracted nipple. Acute mastitis, that is the infection of the breast parenchyma. And I mean, argument while born in here, there's cracked nipple. Now what happens if the nipple is cracked? There's the open area. So the organism mainly gain access through the lactiferous duct, falling contact with carrier of the staph aureus. Basically, the infant mouth and nose within 2 to 3 weeks after birth is colonized by staph aureus. This is a normal commensal in the mouth. So now this, when the baby is suckling, and then sucking the breast milk, if there is cracked nipple, then now the staph aureus will go inside the breast parenchymal tissue and cause the infection of the breast. Okay, so that is called acute mastitis. The most common organism causing mastitis is Staphylococcus aureus, and occurs 3 to 4 weeks after delivery. Presentation, there is marked engorgement of the breast followed by inflammation. Red, and breast will look red, tender, there will be fever with Chilson rigor, tachycardia, generalized malaise and headache. Breast becomes hard, reddened, tense and tender, and overlying skin is tense, tender and hot and flushed. Okay, if it is not treated, then there will be abscess formation. So this is mastitis. Okay, the breast has become red, you know, you can see the redness. This is the mastitis. Treatment is, you all know, it is because of cloxacillin. It is because of staph aureus. So the antibiotic you have to start is cloxacillin. That is 500 milligram per oral 6 hourly for 7 to 10 days. You give her analgesics, like she can take ibuprofen. Continue breastfeeding. If it is very tender, then you have to pump the breast milk out, and infection generally resolves within 48 hours. But she has to keep on feeding the baby because she cannot engorge her breast. Now coming to breast abscess. If the lady comes with mastitis, we have given her antibiotic, and all the features of mastitis and infection does not resolve within 48 to 72 hours. She's still having pain, the pain has increased, it is very tender, then it could be abscess. Okay, the development of the mass with presence of fluctuation. And if you are in doubt, you just advise on ultrasound, and the ultrasound will say there is pus collection, and that is breast abscess. So if it is breast abscess, then no antibiotic can work over there. We have to drain it. Okay, so we have to go for incision and drainage under general anesthesia, and pus has to be sent for culture and sensitivity. And the most, as you know, the most common organism is staph aureus, so you start on gloxacillin. So this is breast abscess. Okay, so you can see here, this is breast abscess. Wound infection, the another complication that can happen in puberty is wound infection, mainly involves the LSCS wound. Okay, the caesarean section has been done, and then sometimes there wound infection of the caesarean section present after fifth, mainly third, fourth or fifth post-operative day. Patient will run fever, and there is discharge from the wound, tender erythematous or fluctuant incision site, drainage of pus or blood. Treatment is proper drainage. Wound has to be opened, suture has to be removed, pus is sent for culture, pus or discharge is sent for culture and sensitivity, and then you start to run antibiotic. You clean the wound properly, do daily dressing. When the slough is not there, when the discharge has decreased, then you can, and the granulation tissue has appeared, then we can resuture the wound if needed. So this is wound infection, right? Gaped wound of caesarean section. Okay, so this is nice clean wound. There is pink granulation tissue over here. Now we can just freshen up the margin and resuture the wound. A pulmonary atelectasis usually occurs in LSCS patient done under general anesthesia due to aspiration. Presentation is fever within 48 hours. This crackles, decreased breath sound, dullness on presentation, diagnosis of pulmonary infection by chest X-ray. You give her broad spectrum antibiotic and she has to do chest physiotherapy. Deep vein thrombosis, I'm not going to go in detail, it is mainly because there is stasis of blood in the low limbs and pelvic veins. Causes are because of prolonged rest, alteration in blood constituent, if there's infection, trauma to the venous wall, that can lead to DVT. Onset is within 1 week of delivery. There's pain in calf, there's rise in temperature, overlying skin become red, there's rise in pulse rate, and there is swelling of limbs. There is difference of circumference of the calf or thigh of 2 centimeters or more at identical size. When you take a calf circumference or you take a thigh circumference in the same site on the both the limbs, there is difference of more than 2 centimeters, then that is called very, very, very high chance that she has developed deep vein thrombosis. So this is DVT, okay? Can you see it? Yes. So this is normal limb and this is the thrombosed DVT limb. Investigation, the most important one is the ultrasound. Prevention, trauma, sepsis, anemia has to be prevented. Dehydration has to be corrected. And she has to do leg exercise following delivery, not if she has developed DVT, okay? After DVT, exercise is not required. But for prevention, she has to keep on walking around. I know, delivery process, any bed, my arms, because the rest gone over now, okay? So ambulation is very important for prevention of DVT. And management, if she has developed DVT, then the medicine, and the medicine people will manage, and mainly the treatment is preparing therapy. And pulmonary embolism, this is also very important. This is leading cause of maternal death. 80 to 90% of cases, the embolus is the thrombus arising from the leg or the pelvic veins following DVT. Okay, the presentation is sudden onset of chest pain. Patient was fine and suddenly she starts to have chest pain. There's dyspnea, cough, hemoptysis, syncope, and cyanosis. And patient can sometimes just die because of pulmonary embolism. So when you do a chest X-ray, you see a decreased vascular marking and lung scanning, massive ventilation perfusion, scintigraphy. So the main diagnosis is pulmonary angiography, that is CT guided pulmonary angio. This is most corroborative of pulmonary embolism. Treatment is heparin. Now coming to obstetric pulses, the most common is seen in puerperium is foot drop. Basically what happens is because of pressure on the branches of the lumbar sacral plexus during labor. Unilateral drop is because of perineal nerve palsy. What happens? And these days we don't deliver the patient in lithotomy position. We deliver in dorsal position. But previously, we used to hang the leg in the stirrups. So when you hang the leg on the stirrup, that is called lithotomy position. The peroneal nerve say, it will bruise between the fibula, that is the bone, and the lithotomy position. Rod, fibula ko bich ma chai common peroneal nerve ke huncha, the damage huncha, bruise huncha. So that can lead to unilateral foot drop, right? Because the peroneal nerve is very superficial, you know, so it can get bruised between the fibula and the stirrups. Presentation: intense neuralgic pain or cramp-like pain extending down on one or both legs as soon as the head descends down the pelvis, weakness of the lower limbs and difficulty in walking. Treatment is analgesic. You have to give analgesics for pain, starter and physiotherapy, and avoidance of pressure sores. Mainly you have to go for physiotherapy. And the last one is the psychological problem in puberium. So mainly it is maternal blues, that is mild and transient depression. It usually go by 3 to 5 days. And so this can happen in many ladies, but postnatal depression and postnatal psychosis, this is pathological. And if she shows sign of depression or psychosis, then we have to tell the psychiatry doctor to come and see the patient, counsel, and if she needs medicine, then we have to start her on medicine. So that's all in abnormal puberium. Okay, I'll be virtual class morning. If there is any question, just let me know. Talk question, talk.